three Sundays off, and I can already feel the strain in my voice from just singing liturgy. How quickly. Grace and peace be yours from God our Sovereign and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ and from the Holy Spirit. Amen. I gotta say, vacations are great, but it is also great to be back with you. Even if it is just for a few weeks before I'm off again for my knee surgery. But while Marcia and I were lying on the beach in Mexico, while we have been gone, we have really kept track of things that were going on at home, not only here at Gethsemane Lutheran, but also at home in our country. There have been many changes in our country in the past 3 weeks. While we were away and since returning, many people have engaged me with the question, what are we going to do now? Referring, I believe, to the sweeping changes in the political scene of this nation. And my answer is really quite simple. In many ways, we continue what we have been doing all along. The church, regardless of what kind of system it resides in, is still called to care for widows and orphans and the sojourners in our midst. The church is still called to heal the sick and to feed the hungry. And I have to tell you what a great joy it was to walk into the sanctuary the first time on the returning home and seeing all of these bags of groceries that are gathered around the foot of the altar. This is what it means to be the people of God. We are still called to bring sight to the blind and to visit those who are in prison. The church is called to proclaim the realm of God and to engage in active nonviolence and to work for distributive justice and to seek that peace which leads to the peaceable kingdom. And the church is still called to speak truth to power. Even as I wrote this sermon, there were tremendous issues that face our nation. Immigration, of course, is on the front burner in response to President Obama's recent action. The awaited grand jury verdict in Ferguson weighs heavily on the hearts of people and the anticipated responses that may come, regardless of which side one is on in that issue. The oil pipeline continues to be a divisive politically, in spite of the fact that in terms of global warming and the environment and the need to develop alternative energies, this one should also be a partisan no-brainer. But it makes no difference. These are the issues which face our nation. And on each side of the partisan divide that grips our nation, there are committed people of faith convinced that they are doing and following the will of God. And in the world, in the Middle East, fanatic Islamists continue their beheading of enemies, giving wings to the cry for boots on the ground. While in Israel, people of faith are being murdered while at worship. All of this in the name of God. Today is Christ the King Sunday. And in light of the world's behavior, this title, this festive occasion where we celebrate Christ as King, this would almost be comical if it were not so tragic. In the story of creation, we are told that God created humankind in God's image. And the pundits have said that human beings then turned right around and returned the favor and created God in their image. And therein lies the major problem with religion. Because God is not Democrat nor Republican. God is not socialist or capitalist. God is not even Christian or Jewish or Muslim or any other brand name that we might claim. Human words cannot define God. God is God. For Christians to proclaim Christ as King is to say that the God whom Jesus proclaimed and the kingdom that Jesus advocated and embodied while he was with us is the where, the why, the how that should enfold all of the earth. It is what defines us as citizens of God's reign. But today the emphasis is not on what the world does or does not do. Today the emphasis is really on what we do. What we as followers of the Holy Christ, how we fulfill our high calling to be servants to both Christ and neighbor in the midst of a world that only seems to know how to serve itself. In the epistle lesson for today, Paul prays for the continued faithfulness of the Ephesians. And in a similar vein, in the Gospel of John, Jesus, on the night before his betrayal, prays for his followers. It is often referred to as Jesus' high priestly prayer. I doubt that these are actual words of Jesus or that it was an actual prayer of Jesus, but I do believe that the author of John undoubtedly captured the essence of what Jesus desired for his followers. So listen as Jesus prays for us, as our King appeals on our behalf. Jesus prayed, "I am asking on their behalf, Holy Father, protect them in your name. While I was with them, I protected them, I guarded them. But now I am coming to you and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves." Jesus' deepest wish for his followers is that we would know the joy of living in the presence of his Father. He says, "I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world." I think that text is the clearest text in all of the Gospels that indicates that to follow the Holy Christ is to act contrary to the dominant ways of the world. The world's way is power and dominion. And for Christians who claim Jesus as their Christ and King, it must give way to the way of Christ, the way of compassion, the way of forgiveness, the way of loving neighbor, the way of grace. But the world will always resist such an approach, calling it unrealistic. But Jesus is not through with his prayer. He goes on to say, "I am not asking, Father, that you take them out of the world." I find that just an absolutely tremendous thought, that Jesus is not asking that we be spared from the conflicts of this world or the trials and tribulations of this world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world. I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world just as I do not belong to the world. And as you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. I find it extremely interesting and provocative. That Jesus, or at least the author of John's Gospel in the name of Jesus, clearly sees our goal as being sent as a witness to the way of Christ in this time and in this place. It is the here and the now of the Gospel story. So the question on Christ the King Sunday is, do we worship and follow a God made from our own image? A God who is as partisan as we are? Or are we obedient to the God of Scriptures, who calls and created us to be God's image, God's body in the world? In good Lutheran fashion, we might well ask, what does this mean, to be the body of Christ in the world? And I think that perhaps there is no better answer than that which is found in the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. A little interjection here is, I think of that which awaits us this afternoon as we pay tribute to Jo and her life. I can't think of words that would describe her better than those. St. Francis continues, Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying, dying to self, that we are born to eternal life. Amen.